Hi everyone, I'm Sachitra Dangala, a software engineer from WSO2 Open Banking team. The deadline for PSD2 RTAs is approaching, and strong custom authentication is a core regulatory requirement of PSD2. WSO2 Open Banking furnishes an out-of-the-box SCA solution that is aligned with the PSD2 regulatory requirements. This webinar will focus on the SCA requirements of PSD2 and what WSO2 has to offer. I will be starting off with a brief introduction to strong custom authentication. Then let's talk a bit about the regulatory technical standards for SCA along with the exemptions of SCA. Then I will be talking a bit about the different SCA approaches that are practiced. Then we will be moving on to the WSO2 specifics, where I talk about the authenticators, how to configure them, and about supporting custom authenticators. After the WSO2 authenticators, I will be talking about how you can customize the authenticator settings by writing your own custom key manage extension module. Let me start off by briefly explaining what strong custom authentication is. Authentication is a process of verifying the identity of a user, and as the name implies, strong custom authentication, or SCA, refers to the strict method of verifying the identity of a user. In order to achieve SCA, multi-factor authentication is used, in which at least two of these elements should be satisfied for an authentication to be successful. The first element is something the user knows, for example, a password or a PIN number. The second factor is something the user owns. It can be a physical factor such as a key, or a virtual factor such as a token. The third is a biometrics, or something the user is, for example, fingerprints. All of you may be familiar with the ATM machines where we are required to insert the debit card and enter PIN number as well. Here the card is the element you possess, while the PIN number is the element of knowledge. The regulatory technical standards for strong custom authentication is stretched over 6 chapters that cover 32 articles as defined here. These articles comprehensively describe the requirements and applications of factors such as, regarding SCA. And these factors include how the three authentication elements are defined, when to exempt from SCA, and the factors to consider in data communication such as certificates. According to PSD2, SCA will apply to custom initiated online payments. As a result, most card payments and all bank transfers will require SCA. RTAs for SCA specifies a list of exemptions that would allow transactions or data access without the need of SCA. These exemptions are useful when improving the customer experience, because having to go through SCA each time a payment is done can be cumbersome. Therefore, the transactions will be evaluated based on their risk factors, which is called transaction risk analysis, and SCA will be performed only in the required situations. WSO2 Open Banking solution provides support for SCA exemptions and fraud detection through the TRA component. Articles on these topics will be soon available in WSO2 platform. Now let's move on to how SCA can be implemented in different approaches. Redirect approach is the most commonly used model, where the PSU will be redirected from the TPP's interface to the bank's authentication interface. And upon successful authentication, the PSU will be redirected back to the TPP's interface. The example I have shown here is from the browser-based. And when the same is done using mobile interfaces, it is called the app-to-app approach. Decoupled approach is considered as a more user-friendly and isolated approach, where SCA is performed while the PSU is in the TPP's interface. This approach can be facilitated by using OpenID Connect, ModRNA client-initiated backchannel authentication. Here, the main advantage is that the user will not be redirected to the bank's interface. Instead, the authentication will happen in an isolated, decoupled manner. Another approach is embedded approach, where the user credentials for SCA will be captured by the TPP itself, and the user authentication will be done by communicating with the bank. The main difference in this is that the user credentials will be captured by the TPP, and it is the TPP who will be talking with the bank and doing the authentication. Now let's dig a bit into the WSO2 specifics. We talked about the different approaches SCA can be implemented in, and for each SCA approach, there can be multiple SCA methods. In WSO2 Identity Server, which is one of the components in WSO2 Open Banking solution, already implemented authenticators are available in the IES Connector store. An authenticator allows you to authenticate the user locally or using a third-party authentication system. Although the basic and the SMS, OTP, web apps, and JARs are packed in the Open Banking solution by default, you can manually add desired authenticators from IES Connector Store as well. The WSO2 authenticator should be added by downloading the relevant authenticator from IES Connectors and configuring it in the admin console and the Open Banking config file. Local authenticators such as Basic Authenticator will be configured to integrate with JDB's user store, and this authentication is done locally. Federated authentication requires the service of a third-party system to authenticate the user. For example, SMS authentication should be configured with a relevant identity provider such as Twilio or Nexmo. Banks may want to add different kinds of authenticators as they wish, and here in WSO2 Open Banking solution, we enable that customization by allowing a range of different authenticators in the IES Connector store. Instead of downloading a ready-to-go authenticator from IES Connectors, another option you have is to write your own custom authenticator from scratch, and the relevant documentation and samples can be found in these pages. Usually, an authenticator consists of two components. First is the JAR file that contains the authenticator logic, and then the web application packed as a WAR file, which typically is used to capture any user input. If the JAR is OSGI, as recommended by WSO2, you need to copy the JAR file in the drop-ins directory and restart the Key Manager component. Then you need to copy the WAR file in web apps directory, and you can refer the Key Manager logs to make sure that the web application is deployed successfully. When you are adding a federated authenticator, you have to configure the authenticator in the application authentication XML file, and here you can define any parameters that may be used by your authenticator logic. Now let's take a look at how these authenticators can be configured. First, you need to add the authenticator JAR successfully in the Key Manager server, as I explained before. Then you need to integrate an identity provider for the authenticator. For this example, I will be showing you how to configure SMS OTP. When you log into the admin console of the Open Banking Identity Server, on the left pane, you can select Add under Identity Providers. Then you need to type the IDP name. When you scroll down a bit, you can see an expandable list of federated authenticators, and you should select SMS OTP configuration. If you had already added a different authenticator JAR and updated the configuration in application authentication file, you will see an entry here with your authenticator name. You can then enter the SMS provider URLs and other information and click register. Make sure to tick the checkbox on top to enable it. Now let's go through a small demonstration on open banking flows. For this session, I will be demonstrating an accounts information retrieval scenario. This is our WSO2 Open Banking demonstration web page, and here we can see a demonstration of the accounts retrieval scenario. Assume that this is the TPP's interface and you are the PSU who will be logging in to the TPP app. And here in the TPP app is configured to show the balances of from different banks to the same PSU. And now we will try to add a bank which will ask for the bank's permission to view its balances. And the customer will have to select the bank. And here, as we discussed earlier in the redirect approach, now we have been redirected to the bank's authentication page. And now we are facing the basic authentication where we had to enter our user email and password. And upon the first authentication, the next step would be to add the SMS OTP. And we're still in the bank's authentication server where the bank will be requesting your consent on your permissions. And upon successful authentication, you will now be redirected back to the TPP's interface. And now the balances can be viewable in your TPP application. Let's go through what happened in the previous demonstration. The open banking flow for accounts is started when the PSU wants to access his account's detail. For example, he will wish to see the balances of a certain bank account. Then the TPP will have to retrieve an access token and then use the token to call the accounts initiation API. With successful initiation, the TPP will be responded with a consent ID. The TPP will have to use this consent ID when he generates an authorization URL, which he should give to the PSU. The PSU will use this link to log into the bank's authentication page and then go through strong custom authentication and authorize the consent, as we saw earlier. When the consent is successfully authorized, the TPP will acquire another token, which can be used to call the information retrieval APIs of the bank. In the previous demonstration, the TPP will have to first sign up in WSO2 Open Banking and then create applications in order to utilize the APIs. These authenticators are bound to each application during application registration. There can be multiple steps configured for an application, or there can be provided a list of authenticators, and the PSU could select which authentication methods to use during authentication. You might still need further flexibility with regard to setting the authenticators. There can be use cases such as setting different authenticators based on TPP properties, or setting different authentication for production and sandbox applications, or use any other property of application to decide and configure which authenticators to be set in that application. This can be done by writing your own custom key manage extension by extending the WSO2 Open Banking's key manage extension. This is utilized during the application registration, which means when a TPP is creating an application, this component decides which authenticators are bound to this app, and the PSUs are authenticated with these authenticators. First of all, you need to add the relevant dependencies into your implementation, and the required jars can be found in lib and plugins folders in WSO2 Open Banking Key Manager component. Your Java class should extend the SCA-based Key Manager client as shown, and the method to override is setAuthenticators method. Let's take a look at a sample class. This is a sample class which is implemented by extending the WSO2 Open Bank SCA-based Key Manager client. And here we have overridden the setAuthenticators method with the desired arguments passed. And as you can see here, as a first step, we have added the basic authenticator, which is a local authenticator. And in line number 57, you can see that the authentication steps are set, and the first step is set as basic authentication step. And from line 59 onwards, step 2 is implemented. Here we are iterating over the registered identity providers, and then we will be setting the second step in line 86. And finally, we need to update the local and outbound authenticator configs with your desired authentication steps. After implementing, you need to build the module and add the component inside drop-ins directory. That is, if your component is OSGI as recommended. If it is not an OSGI, you may add the jar inside the lib folder. Then you have to make sure to update the Key Manager client impl entry in the API Manager XML configuration file, which is inside WSO2 Open Banking API Manager component. So that's it for my the technical webinar on strong customer authentication. And here is a list of upcoming webinars which will be conducted by our WSO2 Open Banking team. If you wish to try out a live demo, as I showed before, you can try it in our site, in this second resource, and you can contact us through this email address. I have also added a few resources which might be useful, and all the resources are available in our solution webpage. So that's it for today. Goodbye.